Here it is, a very special top nine for the very last show. Top nine people watching this show right now. That's right. The top nine viewers for IsoLateNight. Number nine, Jeffrey Gurian. He's the first guest tonight, and I assume he's in here a little early. So Jeffrey Gurian, number nine. And I got this list into my producer very late tonight, like 8:46. I forgot to send it, so that is probably why it's taking a little longer for it to show up. That is completely my fault. I'm taking the L on that one. I want to make sure this is working, though. Or should we just scrap it? There it is. Jeffrey Gurian, number nine. We'll get to you in a minute, Jeffrey. Number eight, Marty Rogowsky. That's my father. Number seven, Katie Feldman. That's my quarantine cutie, who I've been talking to every day for the last 3 months. I'm excited to see her soon. Number six, Perry Schall. Supporter of the show, friend of mine in Philly. He designed the logo. And he told me he's watching tonight. He actually may not be watching. I don't know. Number five, Farad Muhammad, our announcer extraordinaire. I know he's watching. He always tunes in. Thank you, Farad, for all you do. Number four, Daniel Balton. That would be my tech producer, Dan, who's running the show right now. I'm technically paying him to watch the show, but he's watching. Number three, Alex Brazell, my producer in L.A., who I'm not even sure if he's watching. He doesn't watch all the time, I don't think. He's a very busy guy. Number two, Toby Rogowsky. That is my mother. And the number one person watching this show right now, well, there are actually only eight people watching the show, so I couldn't get a number one. Let's get to that first guest who's now been waiting 3 minutes past his time. He's a man who wears many hats. His career in comedy has spanned four decades as a writer, performer, filmmaker, radio personality, and author who's worked with everyone from Milton Berle to Nick Kroll and John Mulaney. He has as many credits as he has famous friends, but recently he added a new one to the resume, that of COVID-19 survivor. Yes, here to talk about his brush with death and the power of laughter that fueled his recovery, it's the inimitable, the incomparable, the man whose audio is giving us a feedback right now, Jeffrey Gurian. Are you there, my friend?
I am. I'm sorry. What is my audio? Oh, it seems to have stopped, right?
Oh, we got it. We stopped it.
Thank goodness for that. Yeah, that's the last thing I needed was feedback.
You only want positive feedback.
Exactly. What a great set you have, man. Good to see you, Scott.
Good to see you, Jeff. We're trying to get your video here up online. Just give us one moment. This is the most exalted segment we have on our show right now. It's called Trouble with Skype. It's our technical difficulty segment. It's when we can't figure out how to get our guests on the show. It's a recurring feature, a staple of the show, if you will. And the fans clamor for it, Jeffrey. What can I tell you?
Yes.
Every time we do this, they say, I love the part where you guys can't figure out how to work the technology.
And we particularly like the feedback and the static.
Yeah, that's always a part of the show. You can absolutely guarantee there are going to be some audio issues. Oh, Jeff, it looks like we need you to turn your camera on. This one might be on you.
I put my cameras on. I clicked on the camera thing.
Is there a camera thing? Uh-oh.
Let me see.
I'm being told we need you to turn your camera on. The great Jeffrey Green. We want to see that beautiful face of yours. I want to see for myself, my own two eyes, how healthy you are these days.
What kind of a show would it be if I'm not?
I see you now. Okay, I think I see you now. Oh, you went away. I saw you for a second. There you are. Okay, we're gonna get you in
now. But I don't see me on the screen.
Okay, ready? It's gonna come up. Dan's gonna work his magic. By the way, I should say who else is on the show tonight. In addition to Jeffrey Gurian, we have Hari Kondabolu. We have an actual magician, Justin Willman. So a lot of magic's being worked right now. But first, the magic of Skype and Hovercast. And there he is.
I am. I actually see me. Amazing.
I see you too, Jeff. Oh, so it is good to see you. Good to know that you are, in fact, healthy. I watched the New York One Piece, so I knew that you were well.
It was nice, right, that they did that. I couldn't believe it. It turned out really nice.
Very nice piece. So for those who don't know Jeffrey Gurian, I don't know. What have you been living under a rock during the quarantine? You are a staple of the New York comedy scene, a legend in the circles here. An observer of the scene, you write comedy, you write the Interrobang, Comedy Matters TV on YouTube. interviewing everyone. I mean, who are some of the biggest names? Just throw them, impress us right now. Throw out some of those, the photos you have on your wall back there.
Oh, well, everybody from Jimmy Fallon on down. You know, Jimmy Fallon, Jim Carrey, Amy Schumer, Amy Poehler, even women not named Amy are on there. Just everybody in comedy. It's hard to think of somebody who's not on my channel.
Everybody.
D.L. Hughley, you know, they showed pictures of everybody. Seinfeld, you know, Billy Crystal.
Woody Allen, you got a picture of Woody Allen.
Yeah, who has a picture with Woody Allen?
Not many.
He actually read my earliest material. He was my inspiration for a lot of my early work. And I got to meet with him, and he read my stuff. And it was kind of crazy, you know, like meeting your idol. I was just a kid. And I saw him two nights in a row. He invited me back to the theater to read my material. Because the first night I went during intermission, I didn't even know enough to wait till the end of the show. And years later, when I became friendly with Jack Rollins, who was Woody's manager for so many years, and as well as Robin Williams and Billy Crystal, he said that Woody must have really seen something in me, because it wasn't like him to do that, to invite me back to the theater. But that was like in my very early days, and it was an amazing experience, something that I'll never forget.
Well, listen, Woody, it was one of my inspirations. Are you kidding me? I mean, all the books he wrote, Without Feathers, and his nightclub album from 1966 is just I think it's some of the best stand-up ever recorded.
Absolutely. His stand-up on the Ed Sullivan Show was just phenomenal. The Berkowitz family dressed as a moose.
Yeah, I shot a moose.
Classic. That will be funny forever.
Forever. I had to pay $150 just to get a glimpse of Woody Allen at Cafe Carlisle to watch him play jazz. He wasn't even doing comedy, but that's what I had to do, the lengths I had to go just to see this man in person. I figured I had to see him at least once before he dies and before I die.
Well, that picture that they showed was taken at the Carlisle. His best friend brought me over to reintroduce Laugh, because I was about to say to him, I hadn't seen him in a long time, and I never know if people are going to remember me or not. So I was going to reintroduce myself and say, hey, Woody, I'm a good friend of Jack Rollins. But instead, I don't know what made me do it. At the last second, I said, hey, Woody, I'm a very close friend of yours. And he just busted out laughing. And he said, oh, really? How long are we friends? And I'm like, decades. And then we took that picture, and he almost smiled.
He almost smiled. That's a great line, Jeff.
He almost smiled, but then realized that it took it back. But he was laughing when I said that to him. And I'm like, this is incredible. I made Woody laugh, you know?
That is incredible. That's almost as incredible as surviving COVID-19, Jeffrey.
That was insane, man. The last 2 months, it took me 2 months. I was so sick. I was sick for 14 days before I called an ambulance. I couldn't take it anymore. I kept expecting it to go away. Who's sick for 14 days and then getting worse and worse? You know how they say your blood pressure is like normal at 120 over 80? My 80 had dropped to 42. So my circulatory system was collapsing. And I was bleeding from my nose. I had full body chills, fever. I was really a mess. And they found it hard to even start an IV. And I had to call an ambulance while I couldn't take it anymore. And they kept me for 4 days. And the only reason they discharged me was not because I was better. Well, it was because I was stable enough to continue recuperating at home, because they were so busy. This was at NYU Langone. They were so busy, they had people in the hallways. Patients didn't even have a room. So my first 2 days, I was in isolation by myself. And then my second 2 days, they put me in a room with three other very sick men, which was a nightmare. They all had the virus to different degrees. The man next to me was a very elderly Chinese man who couldn't speak English. I thought he was dying. He was choking so bad and coughing into the air. I had to call the nurse on his behalf. And I was also nervous for myself, because I'm laying right next to the guy and he's coughing into the air. And there was no place to move me because they had no more rooms. This other guy, they had to rush him to put him on a ventilator. His oxygen suddenly dropped from 93 to 80, which is a common thing with this virus, that you can just suddenly lose your breathing. So it was very hard to stay positive surrounded by that, you know? And when they said they were going to send me home on the fourth day, At first, I didn't want to go, and then I couldn't wait to leave because it was a nightmare. It was really horrible. But the care I got was fantastic. The people, you know, they call them heroes, and it's so true because they literally put their lives on the line every day. And I had to really fight to stay positive. I had to really try to control my thinking, you know, which is...
Right. Well, that's where your comedy training comes in, and you've written the book on the power of laughter and the power of positive thinking. And Alex, I was alerted to your condition by John Mulaney's tweet. He tweeted about you, and we actually said a blessing for you on this show. We called you out, and we were praying for your recovery. I'm so glad to hear that you did recover. But to have so many of your famous friends, these comedians, rally around you, I mean, that had to have been... what got you through this? Am I right?
It was incredible. The support from the comedy community was—it literally brought tears to my eyes. I couldn't believe it. I mean, I wouldn't even read what Bill Burr wrote. Such a touching message that he sent to me in a private message. That's why I haven't posted it. But and Nick Kroll and John Mulaney and Bert Kreischer and Jim Norton. I have people praying for me. The head of Netflix asked me my Hebrew name so he could say prayers for me. The heads of the Just for Laughs Festival contacted me and said, you have a lifetime pass here because it wouldn't be a festival without you.
That's right. Unfortunately, it's not going to be a festival this year, and who knows when we'll be back at Just for Laughs.
Yeah, they're postponing it. But the support that I got was so amazing. And you know what? It's so crazy because comedy is a very kind of a solo thing. You can tend to feel very alone. You write by yourself, you perform by yourself, you know, you're by yourself a lot. And life in general, you can tend to feel very alone. It's not till you're very sick that people tell you that they like you. And it's a hard way to find out.
Yeah. You know,
Ron Bennington really kicked it off because I did my own podcast, the Comedy Matters TV podcast, from the stage of the comic strip. And 4 days before I got sick, Ron Bennington was my last guest. And when he heard I was sick, he talked about it on the show. He and Gail talked about it. And that started this thing of hundreds and hundreds of messages from fans of the show. I was on that show for 2 years. And so many people contacted me. And I can't tell you, I'm a very strong believer in the power of thought and the power of prayer. And when so many people are focusing their energy on one thing, I really believe it has an effect. I was too weak to even answer any of the messages, but just knowing that people were thinking of me and praying for me, it really did help. It kept my spirits up, you know? And I even told a couple of jokes. They put me in the Kimmel wing, and I said, where's Jimmy? As sick as I was like, is Jimmy here? And they're like, who? You know? It was like... I was like delirious at one point. Since I'm a kid, to make myself laugh, I make up stupid names, right? So I came up with this stupid name. I've been doing it since I'm a little kid, with me and my sister. I used to not let her go to sleep until she could make up a name that would make me laugh. So I started thinking of this name, Eichzeich. I don't know. And a doctor came in the middle of that, and he said, who is your emergency contact? And I said, Eichzeich. And he said, who? And I said, oh, I'm sorry. I met my daughter, Elizabeth. I said, Eichzeich to this guy. But I was laying there in bed trying to make myself laugh and telling myself that for whatever reason, this is my path. That,
Well, the path has led you, thankfully, to a good place, back to your apartment in Manhattan. And Jeffrey, I'm looking forward to hopefully seeing you in person again and being on the comedy scene again. I hope these clubs are going to open up and we'll be able to get back to what was once normal, right?
I hope so. You know, I did the Comedy Cellar podcast and a couple others when I got back home. And Noam asked me, he goes, what would it take for you to come back to the clubs? Because, you know, he said, if I was opening June 1st, what would you do? And I said, well, I'd have to check the statistics around May 27th and see how people were doing, you know? It's scary out there. I'm pretty sure I have PTSD. Like, I've been afraid to go out in the street.
I don't blame you, man.
Because nobody knows if you can catch this thing again.
Right.
The hospital called me to check on me, and I said, can I assume I have some immunity? Or, do I stand a chance of being reinfected? And they said, to tell you the truth, nobody knows. So that's a scary thing.
Just keep taking that echinacea. That's all. That's the only advice I can give you.
And I'll tell you something. I think Z-Pak saved me. I took it for 10 days on my own at home. And I really think it protected my breathing. And NYU was doing studies with hydroxychloroquine. Right. And I don't care what people say. It worked for me because I was so, so sick. And the day they started me on that, they gave me a double dose in the morning and a double dose at night. And by that evening, I started to feel a difference already. And they gave me zinc, but they didn't give me any more Z-Pak because I had already been on it for 10 days. So people say all kinds of things about hydroxychloroquine. I was thrilled to get it. When they told me they had that for me, I couldn't, it just, you know, I thought maybe I could be saved now, you know?
Yeah, look, Jeffrey, I see an endorsement deal in your future. Jeffrey Gurian for hydroxychloroquine.
I did a thing for the hospital. I was so grateful to them. I made a donation and then I wrote a thank you note on their website. And a couple of days later, they called me and they said, would you be willing to do an interview to help us with our fundraising? And I said, absolutely, because these people went out of their way. Some of the nurses were so kind. They just sat and held my hand and they told me I was going to be better. And that helped a lot. And they told me they raised $80,000 on the first day. Right. So even if I helped with $10 of that, I just felt like I wanted to do something to help them.
Jeffrey, that's amazing. We have to keep the show rolling here with other guests, but thank you so much for checking.
Are you gonna show my book? This is the book that helped me stay positive.
I'll add it in post, but there it is, Jeffrey's book. Pick that up, Comedy Matters TV. Check out the YouTube channel. You got some great videos on there. And like I said, Jeff, we'll look forward to seeing you in person.
Thank you very much. I look forward to seeing you too.
Glad you're well. Jeffrey Gurian, checking in. Luna Shehechianu for him, and I'm glad he's well. Okay, our next guest. Let's get to our next guest. We got to keep this going. We're already 23 minutes into the hour. My next guest is a writer, an actor, filmmaker, and podcaster, an all-around good guy. But first and foremost, he's a prolific stand-up comedian whose latest special, Warn Your Relatives, is streaming on Netflix. Please say salutations to Hari Kondabolu.
Hey, friend. How are you?
How are you doing? Thanks for your patience there. We had a little technical difficulties, running a little late tonight.
All good. That's a lovely suit.
Thank you. You know, you got to spice things up, keep things colorful in this doomy and gloomy situation we find ourselves in. Hari, man, I'm glad I have you on the show because you're one of these guys that I consider to be intelligent and, you know, clever and funny. And there aren't too many of those, frankly.
I appreciate that, but it's also scary that there aren't more of us.
I know. That's truly troubling. But someone who, you know, who drops Kurt Vonnegut and Jonathan Swift references into his maybe there's a reason why there aren't many. And
most lucrative path, Scott.
Where are you hanging out? Are you in Queens right now, Brooklyn?
No, I'm in my studio in Brooklyn.
Back in Brooklyn. So have you been at home at all with the folks? Or you keeping your distance?
Keeping my distance. You know, it was just hard, but you know, I just want to make sure they're okay and they can get through this. I share a studio apartment with my girlfriend and. That's been really interesting, you know, during this time period, because as a comedian, I'm kind of used to just being at home, pretending to do work, taking naps whenever I want. Like, it's like everyone else caught up with me in a strange way.
Exactly.
And it's also strange because, like, you know, as a comedian, I'm not really accountable to anybody. Right. So I kind of do what I want, but she has a real job and she has to do it from home now. So I constantly feel... like I have to pretend I'm doing work just so she doesn't know the truth about my life. Like I can't just take naps at noon anymore and say, it's part of the process. You don't understand. This is how I work.
Yeah. Every day is take your layabout boyfriend to work day. Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Take your no good Nick comedian. I mean, that's it. The entire world now is on the underemployed comedian's schedule.
Yeah, and, correct.
You know, I mean, I guess nothing's really changed for us, but the world has truly changed forever. And why is everything terrible, Hari? Can you answer that for me?
Oh, boy. Where do we begin?
I mean, there's so much to be upset about. How do you balance it all?
That's such a... therapy is a good place to start in learning how to, put things, compartmentalize things. But no, it's hard, man. I mean, you can only do so much, right? That's the tricky thing. I mean, right now, like, there's a lot of communities that could use financial support. There's a lot of organizations that, like, you know, they're not, like, if you're a business, you're clearly, if you're a small business, there's the risk of, like, going out of business. But if you're, like, a nonprofit or a small organization that supports communities, I mean, nonprofits are basically poorly run small businesses. So,
yeah.
It requires, you know, this is like, for those of us who have some financial means, this is the time to actually support people and organizations that you believe in. Big picture stuff, I mean, I have no idea, man. I mean, Joe Biden was not, I'll be honest, it was not my top choice in this whole thing. So it just feels like, in terms of the country changing, I think mail-in ballots, you know, if that's all we have, that's still something I trust, you know, more so than hoping people show up in the middle of a pandemic. So at the end of the day, I don't know. I mean, I could just tell you to recycle and pretend that'll do it. Just make sure you're still recycling, Scott.
Because 50 years of Earth Day has done so much for us already.
My God.
And I know.
It's mocking the planet. Earth Day is such a lip service for the planet.
Well, listen, you made the point with a tweet about, you know, thank God the global crisis is over, you know, says the other animals after we stopped going outside. But which you know, echoes what George Carlin said 40 years ago about how we're the virus.
Yeah.
And the world's going to be fine. But that's just it. I mean, this is what depresses me, man. It's like, we know this stuff. I mean, you and I know the reality and the seriousness of everything and the fact that we've ruined our planet and we've ruined the people on this planet and we polluted it and we've exploited the lower class, is, you know, all this stuff, but no one seems to care or nothing seems to change. And I truly feel like, I was thinking about this today, it's like we're doomed. I mean, I truly feel like we're doomed. I know we're trying to be funny and all, but no, I don't think going back. I mean, our society has just been torn asunder. Whatever safety nets were there are you know, gone. Hospitals are going to be going bankrupt. Radio City Music Hall is probably going to go bankrupt. How do we go?
Is that right?
No, I don't know. But my point is, like, everything.
That's the thing that affected me most during this interview. You were talking about the end of the planet. Like, not Radio City. Where are the Rockettes going to live?
Exactly. Think about the Rockettes. But my point is, everything from the highest to the low, you know, and then you think about the, you know, the racial and income disparities between the victims. But thank God that our corrupt senators have still been able to enrich themselves during this with insider trading. That hasn't slowed them down. And also, thankfully, you know, unarmed black men are still being murdered despite the pandemic. So, you know, there are still signs of normalcy still remain, at least.
So, I mean, I've seen a couple of videos now of black people being beaten up by the police for not properly social distancing or not wearing a mask. Meanwhile, like, I live across the street from Prospect Park. I am afraid to death to go outside right now. Like, there are people without masks left and right, children running around freely, unmasked, like little viruses trying to destroy your life. Like, it's very frightening.
I mean, truly, I was thinking, do I want to have kids anymore? Like, that's where I'm at right now. Like, I always wanted to be a dad, have children. And now I'm wondering, do I want to bring a child into this world? Do I want to?
But I don't know. If you asked me, like, would you have rather lived 20 years of existence or 30 years of existence or not lived at all? I mean, I'd go for, like, I'll take the 20 to 30, you know? I'll take 20 to 30 over the life sentence, you know? But you just, it's still, what are the alternatives? And so, I mean, I understand the idea of, like, is bringing a human being into this just creating more suffering? But I don't know, man. I always wonder if, like, if there's, I mean, I see the kids that are desperately trying to save us, you know, and themselves, like Greta and the Parkland kids and Malala. And I'm thinking, like, there must be something. Like, the rest of us, it feels like we won't get it until we hit the bottom. And when you hit rock bottom, like, there actually is no coming back necessarily when things are bad enough with the environment and everything else. But these kids are desperately trying to save the planet. Maybe that's what we need. Maybe we need that next generation to finally come in and save us.
Where are you finding the joys, the inspiration to keep going and to create? Are you writing jokes in quarantine? I know you have your own Quarantalk show yourself on Instagram, right?
Yeah, I stopped doing that just because I don't know how you keep doing it. I find it so admirable.
This is the last one, by the way.
Okay, good. you talk to me about the end of the world, and that's how you know it's like the finale. I mean, I've been writing other things and creating non-stand-up things, which has been really helpful, I think, because it's depressing writing stand-up and not being able to do it anywhere. And so that's one thing I've been doing. I've also been watching a bunch of like shows and documentaries, and all the things I said I wanted to do other than working out, I feel like I've done. So in that way, it's like I'm trying to be as healthy mentally and physically as I can. But that's it. I mean, what else can you do? Also, I will say I cherish conversations with people more than ever. Like, it is so much better. Like, in that sense, like, I'm not texting as much as I'm calling people. Mm-hmm. I'm actually using the phone for its original function. Like, it's incredible. I'm trying to see people more than I ever have. So, I mean, that, like, definitely is really, that's been something that's been kind of empowering when you don't feel like you can do much of anything.
Alexander Graham Bell is smiling from This might be the time to get your mango podcast off the ground, by the way. Have you thought about that?
I've pitched my mango podcast to multiple podcast networks. Mango Talk, you get celebrities, we eat mangoes together, and then we talk about the mangoes, and that's a way to talk about cultural things and family and all this other stuff. I don't think people get it. I think you need more people from mango eating backgrounds who are executives at these big podcast companies, because otherwise you're not going to know what you're missing.
Dude, I'm in. I'm 100% in. I'm a massive mango guy. I take my mango dried. I take it fresh. I got two sitting on the counter ripening right now. The Alfonso mangoes, of course.
You got Alfonso mangoes?
Of course. They are the best mango.
Yeah.
I like a champagne mango, too.
Did you get Alfonso's or did you get Atolfo's?
Atolfo? No, I know the Atolfo's and then the champagnes. And there's the big Mexican ones, which I don't care for.
Not as much, yeah.
I'm only speaking about the mangoes, not people.
Right.
I don't care for the Mexicans. You have to be careful when you say that in the context of mangoes.
Well, there are people, I mean, there's always the risk that someone on here is like, finally, Scott, get into the real issues I've been waiting for.
Right. Well, that could be the way to do the podcast. We talk about mangoes, but never mention mangoes.
We're just
throwing different ethnicities around and cultures. Those Filipinos
and the Filipinos are the best.
Yeah, those Filipinos are the best. I would marry one, frankly. You can get them cheap too. I mean, these Filipinos come. You can ship them over here for
we're
like.
We're talking about the mangoes. We're talking about the mangoes.
And also, it should be noted that another positive from all this, besides no school shootings, which the fact that we have to even say that's a positive is really depressing in and of itself, but Dwayne Kennedy's album came out.
Oh, my God. Did you get a chance to listen to Dwayne Kennedy's record?
I did, and I had Kamau and Dwayne on the show the other week, and it's phenomenal. You were instrumental in getting that album made. Is that right?
That's
right.
Me and my friend Ahame Fleoluo, who's an incredible writer, musician. He's my writing partner for the last 15 years. He loves Dwayne, and I love Dwayne. And Dwayne is this prolific comedian, prolific in terms of his influence and being. He's been around since the 80s, but manages not to like do things that would probably help his career, like create a record, like 35 years or whatever. Like, you would imagine you'd have one full-length album by now. So we recorded a bunch of shows in San Francisco at the Punchline, and we edited it, and we did all the work because we really want people to hear this genius's work. I feel like this is somebody who is incredibly brilliant, who's making work that's influenced. Like, all these Chicago comics, you know, like Hannibal and Kumail and Kyle Kinane and Matt Bronger, like, certainly Dwayne Kennedy was one of their guys that was a big influence on that scene. So we wanted to put that out, like to actually honor someone whose work really should be honored.
Well, thank you for doing that, because it's truly phenomenal, and I'm hoping people find out who the hell Dwayne Kennedy is, because you're right, he doesn't get the attention, certainly, that he deserves. And Ari, I guess my last thing here, because we have to keep this train rolling, and I want to talk to you more. Let's have these conversations.
I would love to, Scott. I would love to. It's been too long.
I know, and I appreciate the support that you've given me over the years. I always get a random message from you. Ari said, why aren't you on TV? You'll message me. Like, I don't know if you're drunk or something when you do these things, but like, wow, no one else is messaging me things like that. I'm like, I don't know, Ari. That's a great question.
You're very, like, it's fun to talk to you. Like, you've been doing it grassroots for so long. Like, yeah, your success makes me happy, Scott.
Thank you, man. Likewise. And I wanted to ask about, again, another silver lining, because I'm trying to stay positive. Do you think that now in this post-pandemic era, perhaps fears of contracting a virus might supplant fears of terrorism?
Oh, that's interesting. I've never thought about that as a positive spin.
Right. Maybe have an easier time at TSA with a mask on, you know? They won't be able to tell.
I will say that if people tell me to go home now, I think they're just talking about me heading to my apartment. So that's nice.
Right. You know? Go home. Stay inside. Yeah.
Stay inside. I never thought about COVID being a nice way to not have to think about terrorism. But yeah, I suppose that if you're worried about that, you don't have the same energy to worry about everything else.
Right.
And that's kind of positive, to kind of just focus in on one thing you have no control of, as opposed to like tons of things you don't have control of.
Right. You have to pick your battles, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, brother. Well, speaking of brothers, give my regards to Chuck. And
I will, man. Absolutely.
And let's be in touch, man. The problem is I've been doing the show for too long, and it takes up all day, my mental energy, and I don't get to talk to people. So I'm gonna cut the show, but still talk to people. That's my plan.
That sounds great, Scott. That sounds fantastic.
Right. Have a good night, and I'll catch you later.
Take care, man.
You too. Hari Kondabolu. And watch his special. It's super funny. I watched it again today. I actually watched it twice because I just kept going. I was working, I was playing it, and I just let it go again. You know what else I was watching all day? Oh, this man's Netflix project / web series. No, not a web series. It's a Netflix series. He's got 3 seasons of it. Why? Because he's great. He's a comedian and magician, which means he works on commission. And I don't know. He's currently working for Netflix, where his show Magic for Humans just dropped its 3rd season. It makes for a delightful and truly mind-boggling quarantine binge. Here's a sample of season 3.
This baby's got some power. Oh my goodness. Bet it's got some lift too.
Whoa! Oh, dude! Oh, what in the world?
Make it stop!
Hold up. Sheesh.
I'm magician Justin Willman. I've spent my life attempting to master the art of magic.
Oh my goodness.
Now I'm using magic to master the art of being human.
What the hell?
Have you kids put much thought into your bucket lists?
What's a bucket list?
Kind of not caring today.
I caught the vibe.
Give me a number from 1 to 100.
54. How'd you do that?
Risks include confined spaces, flying debris, collision with fixed objects, emotional injury.
You never know.
All right, can I show you some close-up magic?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, what do I need to do?
Just need to be naked.
Ooh, that's kind of disturbing.
For your age demographic, I think that's...
Magnificent.
I'm a big fan of the Tooth Fairy.
It's pretty dope.
Real people. Real magic.
Oh, how?
No camera tricks. This is Magic for Humans.
3, 2, 1. Oh, yep, that was it.
I can't even process what you just did.
Yes, I'm about to make him magically appear right here.
Ta-da!
It's Justin Willman, Magic for Humans.
Hi, Scott.
How you doing, man?
Pretty good. How are you?
Doing all right. Best we can as we all manage our individual horrors and our societal horrors. There's just a lot of horror colliding into a tornado of shit. And
what is that? What's going on? Why? What's that? Am I missing something? Yeah, no, you're right.
No,
what's not horrible is your jacket. That jacket and tie are the escape we all need.
This is it. I mean, this is literally the least I can do. in times like this. You know what I was thinking?
Some good shorts on.
Oh, hello.
Sorry, that's too much magic too soon in the interview.
Are those the chubbies?
They are now.
They are now.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can't pull the same trick because I may not be wearing bottoms to this. A lot's happened, man, since I last saw you 3 years ago when you you came on my Running Late show in LA. And I said to myself, seeing you perform that night on my show, I said it was only a matter of time before you were going to be the star of your own show. And lo and behold, less than a year later, voila, Magic for Humans on Netflix. But, you know,
I could have said the same thing about you. You know, I did his show and I see it within a year. He's going to be the star of a show that I watch while pooping privately every day and getting frustrated at my lack of knowledge.
Oh, yeah. Were you an HQD?
I was an HQD. Come on.
Nice.
Never been the same, but big time.
Good to hear.
I did HQ with Matt maybe a couple months ago.
When it just relaunched?
Before, it was in December. I did it in December.
Oh, that's
And we had a good time because he's a magic enthusiast and he's hilarious. But, you know,
he didn't
get to do it with the OG.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's right. I saw that. Yeah, that's cool. So you were in New York doing a little...
I was in New York making the rounds.
There you go.
That was for season two, which is crazy. That was only 5 months ago.
Jeez. So did they rush this one out because of the pandemic? Is that what happened here? Or?
I mean, I wish it was like well-planned like that. We shot in 2019, we shot two seasons back-to-back just because it kind of, you know, it's more financially makes sense to not disperse and start all up again. At the time, it was like the grind of the bane of my existence. It was very exhausting, but I'm very glad we did it just because obviously couldn't do it now.
Exactly.
Couldn't do close-up magic now.
I was going to ask about that. Have we seen the end of close-up magic and street magic? I mean, are you ever going to put someone's chain or headphones in your mouth again?
Man, it is weird because I didn't think about it until obviously all this happens. And then I'm kind of thinking on my act. And then I'm thinking about the new season, about just how much magic involves my mouth. Like I put a lot of stuff in my mouth and I hand it to you and you don't think twice about it because it's magic. You're like, whatever. Okay. And I get all up in your face. And I think we'll just have to adapt. We'll just have to revise a little bit, but
it might be
a while till we're within 2 inches.
Man. I mean, a lot of Purell on set, maybe a hazmat suit, you know, even picking a car.
We could do virtual close-up magic right now if I get right close to where you are, right here. If you get right up to me.
I don't even know the angles here. I gotta. Yeah. Oh.
There we go.
Is this?
Ooh. Yeah, that's good.
I try not to show the profile too much on the show here, Justin. Okay.
See, this is what close-up magic feels. This is how close-up magic will be done moving forward.
I haven't kissed someone in a while, Justin. You're tempting me right now.
Well, I've been kissing a baby.
Yeah. Gosh.
Wondering when it's no longer acceptable to kiss your baby on the mouth.
You've been doing some terrific quarantine content, quarantine magic shows with your lovely assistant, your son, Jackson, infant son. I actually have an example of one of these. Can we show this, Dan?
Today's lesson is the rope trick. Check it out. Piece of rope. I'm going to gather the middle up just like this, and I'm going to cut the middle of the rope. Watch this. I just cut the middle like that. Now watch. What's amazing is that I can make the rope just restore back. No.
Myself lately. There it is.
There it
the
is.
Rope trick. And your son reaching for the scissors. Man.
This kid, I tell you, he may not have a future in magic, but he is a comedy god. He's got like this Jack Benny vibe to him. His, you know, just stoic kind of straight man. These lookaways, kind of like he's, you know, trying to convey to you, the viewer, that this dingus he's with, me, the dad, is just like a hopeless fool. Just, you know, these takes he does. You can't teach that. And I didn't teach it, and I don't have it. So
he's starting to put the hand on the ratchet. Dude, that is, you're right. He is such a good straight man. And the timing with the scissors, I mean, you can't make, how many times did you practice that with him to get the timing down on the scissors? How many takes was that?
Well, I've figured out this formula where, like in that case, I kind of, you know, obviously going into it, I had to tell my wife, hey, I'm going to do a bit where I'm going to hopefully have Jack grab the scissors. She was close by. We found the dullest scissors. But I get him desensitized to the rope. So play with the rope a bunch. Oh, because a new thing he's very fascinated by. So he's fascinated by the rope at first. he gets over the rope. So then I know when the scissors is introduced, he's going for the scissors. First try, first take.
The clock
goes right for him. Yeah.
This being the internet, Justin, how many angry comments did you get on that one? How dare you let your infant son touch
only those? Like a couple who kind of didn't get that it was for comedic intent. And then, you know, obviously, like someone was like, well, what happened? Okay. Yeah. He's okay. Yeah. He dropped him. He gave him to me. But you got to have that. I feel like if you're not getting some hate, then you're not doing it right, I think. At least that's what my therapist says.
Yeah, but it's not even hate so much. It's just they're just some dummies out there.
Yeah.
I mean, it's absolute stupid people. And, you know, on the one hand, you're like, okay, I'm glad you're a fan of mine. But the other hand, it's like, am I, though? Do I need you as a fan? If you don't get what I'm doing, if you don't understand that basically everything I'm saying is a joke, then I don't know if I feel good that I attracted you as a fan in the first place.
It's just weird that they have the ability to be on our radar. You know what I mean? Which is unusual. But I think, you know, like you'll have, I'm sure I've gone through a lot of like bouts with just online criticism and it, you know, cause I hosted Cupcake Wars. Come on. I went through a lot of bouts with online criticism, but then like with Magic for Humans, you know, somebody will make a comment and like, you know what I hate? I hate this show because in this episode, blah, blah, blah. And they're referencing like the last episode. So they clearly watched all of it.
Right.
And then have, I don't know. It's a good thing.
Hate is love. It's just a different form of love. If they truly didn't love you, they wouldn't spend all this time watching you and consuming your stuff. So
exactly,
that's the way you got to
Seinfeld's bit, right? The difference between sucks and great is like razor thin.
Yeah.
You've heard of him, right? Seinfeld. He's good.
Bernie Seinfeld. Yeah. No, he's good.
Bernie Seinfeld. Yes.
I want to know. I'm a huge fan of Tim and Eric, and absolutely produce your show, Absolutely Productions, which is. If you don't know, they're behind all of Tim and Eric's stuff. Nathan for You, Eric Andre's show, aka the funniest shows ever made.
Yeah.
And there's certainly a bit of an editing aesthetic borrowed from those guys. But beyond that, how involved were Tim and Eric themselves? Were they?
Well, they're so busy with like all their stuff. They're always around. So, you know, they're there to have their brains picked. But really, I think the idea of doing it with their company, you know, like I think what makes the show have the pace that it has and kind of just the ridiculous absurdity here and there that makes it, I think, palatable to Magic fans and non-Magic fans is that Tim and Eric brand. So, you know, we'd cross paths in the kitchen at the water cooler or at the coffee maker, and I'm like fanboying out, trying to just act normal, be cool. And they're just the nicest, sweetest, most normal guys. Like they don't act like Tim and Eric. They're just sweet professional family men. And so I kind of sometimes either wish, I'm not sure if I wish I had more interactions with them or am glad I don't, you know, they say don't meet your heroes. So I've got just enough of them. And they're great. But yeah, to get that tone, you know, that is such like I'll have people tweet me like, oh, this show reminds me of Tim and Eric. You know, people just don't know that they're the EPs or the Eric Andre show, which I feel like is a nice, lovely family to be in. They have good taste.
You're in great company. Absolutely. Yeah. And it's funny because no one really gets to see Tim and Eric as Tim and Eric because literally every time they're even doing media appearances, interviews, they're always doing a bit. They're always not truly being themselves, but you're one of the rare people who have seen them at their natural.
Yeah. And it is weird. It's a weird thing that they're so just normal dudes, you'd never know.
And how much influence does David the Dean Porter have on the show? I mean, Magic for Susans, by the way, maybe the greatest element. Listen, I'm friends with DDP.
I love DDP. Magic for Susans, like, you know, he's one of the co-executive producers on the show. And, you know, season one, we're putting ideas on the board and we're like, oh yeah, we need to have some little interstitial bumpers, you know, some palate cleansers. And I remember he's like, how about just do magic for people named Susan? Like they're all Susans and you just do a trick. And we're kind of like, okay, yeah, we'll put that on the board. I'm sure we'll take it off the board when we come up with something better. And thank God we never came up with something better because it turned out to be gold right there.
Well, you know, you got to trust DDP. And then he ended up getting Susan Sarandon.
Yeah. I made her my desktop wallpaper moving into season two because it was like my vision board. Like, she was my golden goose. We must get Susan Sarandon. And yeah, it's the secret works. When you manifest something, you can make it happen like that.
Now, did you get her high for that hit, or did she show up that way?
You could. She read as a little buzz to you.
A little bit, you know. It's legal. Yeah,
maybe some drops, or I don't know, some candies. I don't know. She was pretty chill. She'd never seen the show. Her son's a big fan of the show and is a real sweetheart. And you know, he just thought it'd be really cool for his mom to do it. And she loves her son, so he did it. She did it. It was great.
It was great. I was really hoping. I was texting and emailing him today. I was going to try to pull my own magic trick and make DDP magically appear, but he's busy and he couldn't do it. And,
I would love to see you make DDP appear.
God, he ruined the bit. Thank you, Dave.
His beard, that furry beard.
I know. Beard goes. Was it his job to also find the most awkward people walking around the streets of L.A. to do your
I mean, listen, that was a job. That was... It's all hands on deck, kind of divide and conquer. But very much like when you're out in the world, you know, you kind of like, and you have limited time. Okay, we have time to like run this bit two or three times. You kind of have to get really picky. And DDP always has a great eye for like, who's someone who looks just a little bit off the beaten path, like who will truly give you an uncensored reaction. And, you know, takes one to find one.
Absolutely. I have a few very specific questions, and if you haven't watched the show, guys, you gotta watch it. Three seasons. It's truly, not only is it funny because you're funny, it's just mind-blowingly entertaining, and it makes me sometimes terrified, frankly, by what you're able to do.
High praise. Thank you.
Do you know Nick Swartzen's bit about magicians? Have you heard his joke?
Yeah. Remind me, because I'm a big Swartzen fan, but this was a recent bit, right?
This is on his comedian. Yeah, he's a Netflix special that came out last year, and I had him on the show a few weeks ago, and yeah, he said
it's a David Blaine bit, right?
Right, he's horrified. He said he's horrified by really good magic, like it shatters your reality. He's like,
yes.
How do you just let magicians walk amongst us? You know, he can't understand how the first person ever started doing magic, like. How come people didn't freak out and murder the first guy ever to do magic? Like, what are you doing? Rabbits don't come out of hats. They never should. And just like shooting the guy, like, psh, psh. If anybody does that again, you fuck.
That's so true. Like, I had him on a show I did once back at Meltdown. And, you know, as soon as it went from like fun, casual chat to a magic trick, he like, you could feel his ass tighten up. And he's very much like, What's the bit? What are we doing? You know, like kind of really, really standoffish. But not to name drop, he actually texted me today because he was watching the show, and he was to the segment where I was naked, and it's like, I was enjoying your show until you're naked now. What am I watching? So
there's pornography adjacent elements to the show,
but it's family friendly, guys. It's family friendly. The person who does the blurs at Netflix did a real stand up job. You know,
How about that beach bum who said he makes pornography? Did you ever get a chance to watch any of it later?
I did not. I don't know if he documents it. He makes it, but he doesn't, you know, immortalize it on film. Yeah, that's an example of just the unique characters that Los Angeles has to offer.
A never ending supply. How many people are genuinely pissed off after interacting with you? That broccoli. That broccoli kid didn't seem like a happy kid.
Oh, the broccoli kid was not happy. You know, for the most part, people are pretty happy about being on the show. Like, I think it helps. Once we finished season one, it was already out there. It kind of helped that people had seen the show because they know it's not the kind of show that's there to punk them or make them look stupid, you know, for the most part. I did a bit in season two where I was pumping breast milk at a coffee shop from myself. So like, you know, almond milk and soy milk and stuff. And one guy was really loving it, was slapping me on the back and was saying a bunch of ridiculous things, but he hadn't, because it was a hidden camera part. We didn't have him sign the release until the end. And then he was like, I apologize, guys. I can't sign the release. I'm a priest. So that'll never be seen, but it really completed my full picture of this man. It was something. So for the most part, people aren't upset, but sometimes they get a little self-conscious.
Sure. You know, I've been there. I've been there with the when the release comes, it's a whole different ballgame.
A whole different ballgame.
I need to ask about this too. I saw that Rob Thomas tweeted about season 3. He called you my friend, Justin Willman. How did you become friends with Matchbox 20's Rob Thomas?
Listen, guys, I got to say, learning a couple card tricks changes your life. You just got you get to hang with people you never thought you'd hang with. I did a benefit show in Virginia for Jason Mraz, who's become a friend over the past 10, 15 years, because he's a magic buddy and we have some mutual friends. He's a budding magic enthusiast. And I used to go on tour with him. Anyway, Jason had me come do this benefit show. Rob Thomas was also on the show because, you know, Rob Thomas and Jason are buddies. And then we all went out drinking afterwards. And Rob's the coolest guy. He looks just like he looked back in the day. This man hasn't aged. He's a dreamboat. He can still crush a tune. This man's awesome. And he luckily shows his love and called me a friend, which is crazy.
Does he ever push you around?
He doesn't push me around.
Does he call you at 3 a.m.?
I wish. He always calls at a very respectable hour. Actually, he's never called. Never called.
If I were friends with Rob Thomas, I'm just saying, if I were friends with Rob Thomas, I would be milking that for all it's worth. I would introduce myself at parties as Scott Rogowsky featuring Rob Thomas.
You may have heard of me as Rob Thomas's friend. Yes.
I mean, if I were you, I would call my show Magic for Humans with Justin Willman featuring Rob Thomas.
No joke, we were going to do a bit. We had a card on the board. We were writing season 2 and 3 that was going to be this great Rob Thomas cameo thing. And the timing just didn't work out. But hopefully it will come back because we love ourselves some Rob Thomas. And it was such an inside joke, like a pet bit, that when I wrote all the writers a little thank you note, I had these custom Rob Thomas cards made up where it's him looking all dreamy and it says, you know, thank you from Rob Thomas.
He would only make the show even smoother. If that's possible.
It's possible.
You know?
So, you got another one?
Another Rob Thomas?
A little Rob Thomas ref?
I mean, how would you describe a relationship? Is it just like the ocean under the moon?
It's the same as the emotion that I get with you, Scott.
Boy. Can I ask about someone else, perhaps in your orbit?
Uh-huh.
Tell me about your rivalry with Michael Carbonaro. How does Carbonaro affect?
Why do you think we have a rivalry?
I don't know. I'm just throwing this out there.
Magicians all hate one another?
No, but not the hating. What's the relationship with, like, other magicians? Penn and Teller, for example. Are you buddies with those guys now?
Well, I don't know Penn and Teller, like, very well. I think they're familiar with me and the show. We've kind of met very briefly. I actually did an episode of an old CBS show, The Defenders. I don't know if you remember that. Jerry O'Connell, Belushi, where I did a scene with Penn and Teller. And then I met him with Penn. And then I met him again a year later. And he did not have any clue who I was. So I was like, I'm not going to push it because they're truly some of my heroes. And I don't want to have a bad experience where I feel conflicted about that. Right. Copperfield's very sweet. Don't know him too well. David Blaine, we've hung out a bunch. He's awesome. And, you know, he's a strange bird. He's David Blaine. He's what you'd hope he would be. But yeah, Carbonaro, we have a bunch of mutual friends. I think when his show first came out, I mean, for several seasons, I would tell him it's like the was the best magic show on TV. It was very, no one could do what the premise of that show is, I think, than him, how he keeps a straight face. I mean, he's a very fantastic actor. Yeah. But, you know, all magicians end up kind of having little tiffs and tats, spits and spats. Whiffs and whats.
Is there a breakdown between comedy magicians and the more straight, like big spectacle guys like your Copperfields or Blaine's or Chris Angel? I mean, is there like a stand-up comedy versus a sketch comedy, improv comedy divide sometimes?
Sometimes, but I think because the art of magic is so, like, for some reason, like in comedy, you know, there can be many greats. There can be many household names. But in magic, you know, it kind of feels like there's such limited real estate that magicians tend to get a little territorial near the top. You know what I mean? And they think that anyone, even if it's a different genre than them, that gets a little bit close to ascending into their turf, you know, it kind of makes you a little uncomfortable. And I get it in one respect, just in that magic is not as kind of, the different types and genres and tastes of magic are not as well known, I think, by the mass population as music and comedy, but I think we're getting close. So I don't know. I feel like the success of anybody in the magic field is good for everybody.
Yeah. Does the idea of like a Vegas residency appeal to you in the future?
No, I can't. I can't handle Vegas for more than 2.5 days.
Yeah,
I mean, maybe when, like, you know, Britney Spears and Elton John, I'm sure their Vegas experience is quite different than, you know, than anybody else's. So that kind of posh deal would be nice, but no time soon.
It's a good time to be in Vegas right now.
If you see me play in Vegas within the next 2-3 years, know it is against my will, Scott.
I'll keep that in mind. But Josh, I know you got your young son to get back to and your wife who's probably taking care of him right now while you're going AWOL with me.
Yeah.
I will let you get back to that. And truly, 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 you are one of the greats. If not, I think like you're at the top of the comedy magic world right now. This show is so freaking good, so well done. It's a credit to everybody on the team, on the staff and you, because truly, you know, what it comes down to do this really well, you have to be a good actor. You have to be, right? I mean, that's part of it. Because look, there's so many magicians out there, just as there are so many comedians out there, and many of them aren't known. They just aren't getting there. And I'll go on YouTube. I'll look at people doing tricks on YouTube, and it's just like, yeah, you don't have it, man. You don't have you're not charming. You don't have the ability to like act and be, you know, natural on camera. I mean, that's a huge element to be successful in this field, and you've got it.
Well, thanks, buddy. I think it's taken me many, many years just to figure out how to act like a normal person, which is for some reason really hard, you know, and every day of my life it's hard. But I feel like that's kind of maybe what makes it feel a little relatable and approachable, and that's very, very sweet of you. So thank you.
I'm hoping that season 4 will be able to be produced eventually. And
Far Away Magic. That'll be the new segment.
That's it. I'm into it. Justin Willman, follow me on Instagram. And the Magician Starter Trick, I bought mine today.
I saw that you did. Yeah, I made a magic kit.
Yeah.
To raise money for COVID healthcare workers. But yeah, social distancing Magician Starter Kit. So it's on its way to you, Scott. They're on my website if anybody wants one.
JustinWillman.com. Check it out. And thank you for what you're doing, buddy. And give my best next time you see him.
All right. Will
do. Adios. Justin Willman is out. He's out. We're out. And that's it. That's a wrap on the show. And that's a wrap on ISO Late Night. Because like I said, folks, this is the end, my friends. What a way to go out. Justin Willman, truly one of the greatest talents, I think, working today. And if you don't know, now you know. Now you got to watch his show. 3 seasons of it. And maybe a 4th coming soon. A huge, huge thanks to all of you, all 8 or 9 of you who've watched, who've contributed to the charities. Thank you, of course, to Dan Balton and Alex and my writers who didn't help with this one, Max and Al, but they've definitely helped in the past. Farad, couldn't do this without you and your terrific announcing. Perry, I don't know if you watched tonight, Perry, but your logo is phenomenal. I love it. There are the credits there. We'll see the credits. But yeah, thanks for watching. Thanks for making this fun. I'm going to do more stuff. There'll be more stuff coming. And so stick around for that. You know, who knows what form it'll take. I want to do the baseball show. I'll probably still do the baseball show in some form or another. But Isolate Night. Saying goodbye. Signing off. Thank you, Sam, for watching. I don't know if Samantha was watching. Oh, I should have put her on the list. You should have been in my top 9, Samantha. I'm sorry I left you off. Yeah, I don't know what to say. This was started on a whim, and it's going to end on a whim. And it's given me something fun to do for 2 months. I can't believe it's been 2 months. Time is really weird and flexible right now, and I'm not even sure how it's been 2 months sitting in this chair. But thank you for being part of it. And Jack at Hovercast, who was a huge help, and Hovercast in general for making all this work. And yeah, what can I say? The guy who did the animations, I forget his name. But I won't forget you. Yes, you, for watching. So until next time, you can find me on the socials. Check out my stuff on all that. You know, Quiz Daddy's Closet is where I really want you to follow. Keep buying more stuff. I need to get rid of all of my crap, and you'll enjoy it in your new home. I'm signing off, and at this point, it doesn't matter about my rating. So I'm just going to say, please stay well. Thank you to Jeffrey Gurian tonight, Hari Kondabolu, Justin Willman, my guests, all my guests on the show, and thank you, my viewers, for watching. Stay safe. Stay sane. Stay savage. Bye.